God's house this morning. We'd like to welcome our visitors who are here with us today. It's an honor that you're worshiping with us, and I pray you would come and be with us again very soon. Our worship on page 203. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
In the name of the earth.
If you, O Lord, kept the record of sin, O Lord, who could stand? Since we are gathered to hear God's word, to call upon him in prayer and praise, and to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. We pause for a moment of silent confession before our God. And we confess, Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We sing together today the words of the intro, which you will find printed on this insert in your bulletin.
All the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that he had gathered, and the people they had acquired from Haran. And they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abraham passed through the land to the place at Shechem, the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. And then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "To your offspring, I will give you this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord, who had appeared to him. And there he moved to the hill country to the east of Bethel, and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord, and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abraham journeyed on, still going toward Negev. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Epistle of Romans chapter 4, 1 through 8, and 13 through 17. When then shall we say was gained by Abram, our forefather according to the flesh? For Abram was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. And what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And the one who does not work, but trusts him who justifies them godly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Instead, David also speaks of the blessings of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. But it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs. Faith is null, and promise is void. The law brings wrath, but where there is no law, there is no transgression. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We rise to honor our God in the hearing of this gospel. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the third chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And this man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, and whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess together our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 206.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. Then he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. We continue with the singing of our next hymn. Explains it a little bit further to him in verse 5, where he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." So Jesus is saying to be born again is not like a lot of evangelicals will tell you today, either by your decision or something that you do. Jesus equates being born again with being born of water and the Spirit. So what Jesus is telling Nicodemus, this old and wise teacher of the Israelite people, is even though he was old, even though he was very well studied, even though he was very comfortably positioned in the hierarchy of Israelite religious society, and he had devoted his belief, he was wrong. And Jesus said that he needed to start completely over. Change was imperative. Jesus says that without a total reset of wrong theology on salvation, that no matter how much you have personally invested in it, no matter how much you might be convinced of it, if your theology of salvation is not in line with the Word of God, then it must be wrong. And it must be abandoned wholesale. Without a spiritual reset, what you think you see as being the kingdom of God isn't really the kingdom of God. Without a spiritual reset worked by God, you cannot enter into the true kingdom of God. Yes, change is imperative, and the Holy Spirit will affect that change when we get out of the way and let him do his work. Let me give you an example. Have you ever been reading something in the Bible and you come across something that you wish weren't in there? You came across something in the Bible, you didn't like what it said, so you twisted and turned around your interpretation of what it said to make it say something completely different. Have you ever heard something preached or taught here at Trinity, something that was directly in line with the Word of God, something that has been taught by the church from Jesus through the apostles down to this day, and thought in your mind, "Well, Pastor, that's okay for you, but I think you're wrong." Like Nicodemus, you're wrong. And you need a spiritual reset if your thinking is not in line with God's Word. You know, if you go one verse past the reading that's recorded for today, Jesus says this to Nicodemus: "Whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." This is another thing that needs to get changed, a spiritual reset in a lot of people's brains. Despite what some theologians teach, that basically everybody is born good with just a few flaws, or that even if you are sinning, that you're just not held accountable for it until you reach a certain age, Jesus says that we are all born condemned. Our spiritual normal setting is off. That's how we're born. And King David agreed with this when he wrote in the Psalm, "I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." You see, you can't go back and make it right with God and be uncondemned, all because of our natural spiritual nature. So you see, change is imperative. And you cannot do it. But God can. Once again, you can see poor old Nicodemus, his brain is probably about ready to explode at this point, trying to understand all of this. So he drops back to an argument he thinks is going to win, and he says that it is impossible to be physically born again. He says, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? No, you can't. And it is just as impossible for you to climb back into some kind of spiritual womb on your own and to be born spiritually uncondemned without sin. There's no method. There's no discipline. There's no work you can do that. And anyone who tells you otherwise lies because they contradict Jesus. So I want you to listen. I want you to listen right now to what Jesus says is God's plan. God's plan to rescue you from your natural condemned state, from certain and eternal death. By the Holy Spirit's guiding, and by His power, now through Jesus' words, I want you to receive the blessed gospel into your minds and into your hearts. Jesus says that on our own, by our sinful nature, no matter how much we have invested in our personal theology that is false, what we think we see is not the kingdom of God. How do we see it then? Jesus tells us in verse 5, unless one is born of the water and the Spirit. He's talking about baptism. Here in our Lutheran church, the norm is that we baptize infants as soon as we possibly can. And we look at a baby, especially a newborn baby, and they look so clean, and they look so innocent. They look like a pure wellspring of pure, clean water. But guess what, folks? They flow from a polluted source. And that's us. So they are not clean. Impure water needs to be purified. And there is a pure source of water that can do that. Water that brings with it God's Spirit, and that is holy baptism. Remember, we're born condemned. That means everyone. That means babies. And yes, Jesus says that everyone must be born again to see and to enter the kingdom of God. So a new spiritual birth is needed. Because as Jesus says in verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. As you are born, as all of us are born, through our human fathers, that is all you will ever be, flesh. And as the Bible uses that word, it means sinful and corrupt. To be spirit, one must be born of the Holy Spirit. Even as Jesus' conception by the power of the Holy Spirit caused him to be born without any sin. Oh, so I get it now. We have to go do baptism, right? That'll make everything all right. Well, is it our doing of baptism that works this wonder? No. As always, it is the work of the Holy Spirit combined with God's Word in the water. Baptism is never active doing on our part. It is always passive receiving, no matter how old we were when we were baptized. The Bible never speaks of baptism in any other way except for passive receiving. The Bible never says go and get baptized. It always says be baptized. Have baptism put on you from outside by the Word of God. Now, we can't rationally understand that. We can't figure out how that works. But that's okay. because our rational minds are clouded and corrupted by sin and will never understand it. But this is the mysterious, wonderful work of the Holy Spirit, just like Jesus says in verse 8. He says, the wind blows where it wants. You hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. And so it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. You know, you've seen baptisms done here before, right? Have you ever seen, when I put the water on the person, a dove come down from heaven? Have you ever heard a booming voice of God? No. Nevertheless, God says that when you are baptized, you receive the Holy Spirit. You are indeed a beloved child of God. He says it, and it is, whether we see it or not. The Holy Spirit blows where He wishes. And where does He wish? He wishes to be in those that He claims through holy baptism, born of the Holy Spirit. You see, God does all the work, and He makes it really pretty simple for us. We just have to receive these gifts that He's given to us and not complicate them like Nicodemus did. Well, on whose truth then? You know, Nicodemus is losing this argument, and he can see it. So he falls back on his last line of defense. He says, well, basically, who says you can tell me this kind of stuff? On whose authority is this new truth being preached? Well, it's on Jesus Himself. Through Nicodemus, He says, He is teaching him heavenly things. That's what He says in verse 12. Now it is Jesus, He's the one who knows these heavenly things. And why? Because He speaks to us that which He knows. Because He's been there. And He's returned there. Jesus says in verse 13, no one who has ascended into heaven except Him who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. You see, Jesus came to save us, yes, but He also came to tell us God's plan. He brings us this word of salvation about baptism directly from His Heavenly Father. So who are we to argue? This spiritual reset, this rebirth by water and the Spirit has one main purpose other than saving us, and that is this: to turn us from faith in ourselves and our false notions of righteousness and turn us to Jesus and to the righteousness we receive from Him. Jesus goes on to say in verse 14 and 15, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, and whoever believes in Him will have eternal life. He is referring back to that Old Testament account where the people of Israel had rebelled against God for the umpteenth time, and God sent fiery serpents into their camp. And these fiery serpents would come, and they would bite a person, and it was a deadly bite because the person would die. And God told Moses, I want you to fashion a bronze serpent. I want you to put it high up on a pole. Put it up where everybody can see. And the people will look to that snake on a pole. And I will heal them. This was a foreshadowing. The reality is in Jesus Christ. He fulfilled that foreshadowing of the serpent on the pole. Because we are dying. Each and every one of you has been bit by the serpent of sin, the same serpent from the Garden of Eden. God has placed, though, the means of our salvation, Jesus Christ, high upon the cross. As He is lifted up, God turns our eyes towards Him, towards our source of salvation in faith. And in Father-given, Spirit-dispensed faith, we are rescued by the Son's death in our place. And by His resurrection, He rescues us from death. So my friends, believe in the One who is lifted up for you. Be saved by the Father's will, by the Son's work, by the Spirit's gift of delivering this gift to you in word and in sacrament. This is how God loves His world. Not with emotion. Not with calling us to straighten up first, and then he will do something about it. But that he gave his one and only Son. And whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. That is God's plan of salvation. God loved the world he created, even though we, the crown of his creation, ruined it all. But our sin did not stop God from loving us. He loved his world and excluded no one. His desire, as Paul writes to Timothy, is that all people be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, and that truth is Jesus Christ. And so the Father lifted Jesus up upon a cross that we might see and believe and have eternal life. God's love brought results. He offered the ultimate sacrifice, his Son on the cross, for the world that he loved. Faith saves, but not faith in anything in particular. Faith in the Son of God, who was given as a sacrifice for you and for me. Faith given to us by the Holy Spirit, by his chosen means of word and sacrament. At this point, there's nothing left for poor Nicodemus to argue about. He must have been awestruck at this point. No human being could have possibly conceived of such a plan. No human being could have possibly imagined what Jesus has just said. It could not work without God. And so here is God, Jesus, speaking to him, revealing God's wonderful gospel plan of salvation, which is beyond our understanding. 17, these beautiful words. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. It took some time. The Bible tells us that Nicodemus got his spiritual reset. He believed and he received. And I look forward to meeting Nicodemus someday in heaven. But for now, you and I, who have been born of water and the Spirit in our baptism, we know this. Believe in the One lifted up, and you will be saved. And to that we can respond in joy.
Amen.
Please rise. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. The prayer system in your bulletin, we've had these special prayer requests for the family of Dwight Beasley, who passed away last night, for Sam Evers, who is going to be having a heart ablation tomorrow, for Margaret Hamilton, who is undergoing more tests after her surgery this week. And we pray for Alicia that get rid of her rash and be back with us soon. Let us rise now as we lift our praise and praise to God. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Eternal Father, you have called your church out from the unbelieving world to walk according to your word and way. Grant us to be like faithful Abram, heeding your word and trusting in you, knowing that wherever you lead us, you will provide us with all the blessings we need for faith and life until you call us to our eternal home. Lord, in your mercy.
In our grace.
Gracious Father, though through your holy word of the gospel you have called our faith into existence and given life to us who are dead in sin, grant that all pastors, including John Jenkins, Carl Beckwith, and Fred Meinhardt, would faithfully preach that we are righteous before you through faith alone and not by works of the law. Sustain and strengthen all pastors and their hearers through your blessed word of forgiveness. Bless also all missionaries, including the Federowitz family, who bring the saving message of Jesus to the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
praise. Merciful God, you sent your Son not to condemn the world, but to save it. When your people doubt your love for them and are troubled by their sin and burdened in their consciences, remind them of the great love you demonstrated for them by the lifting up of your Son on the cross for the sins of the world. Grant them the peace that comes from their baptisms in Christ, through which their sins are daily washed away and drowned the old Adam. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Almighty God, you have set in place all earthly authorities to provide for peace and justice. Grant them to be faithful and diligent in their positions, that they may work to protect the weak and vulnerable. Bless all who labor to provide protection, including those in our armed services, as well as local safety personnel. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Heavenly Father, you graciously provide for all of our needs of body and soul. We pray for all of those who suffer any kind of affliction, be it spiritual, mental, or physical. Including today, we pray for the family of Dwight Beasley, for Sam Evers, for Alicia, for Margaret, for Pam and Kay, Willard and Linda, Cindy and Terry, for Alan and Dorothy, and all of those that we now lift up before you in the silence of our hearts. Grant healing and recovery according to your will. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
God of all comfort, your great love for us was shown through your Son's sacrifice on the cross. Bless us now as we receive the fruits of that sacrifice in his body and blood, given and shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Grant us to receive this supper in repentant faith, that our consciences may be cleansed, and that we might be assured of our eternal fellowship with you and all your saints. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The service of the word concluded. We now continue with the service of the sacrament found beginning on page 208. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should in all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
do this in remembrance of me.
same way, also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.